right up to the Bosnian War of the 1990s and beyond. The gunman also pointed to Norwegian mass killer Anders Breivik as an inspiration. Well, Foreign Affairs writer Tim Marshall is here in the studio with me. He was armed to the hilt, and on his weapons were all kinds of inscriptions. What stands out for you? There are some very ancient historical references there and more modern. Let's have a look at some of the older ones.
They're all part of a piece. They are all part of the same narrative, the same mindset. And in his head, he will have been, he thinks himself as a warrior. A warrior in a historical, ethnically based war. And the irony that he's killed people in New Zealand, which itself was previously not a white country, taken over by white people, and then he goes off killing people, will be completely lost on him, because in his head he is fighting this ethnocentric war for white supremacy, and it is of a piece. Start back in history. There's a reference to the Battle of Tours in the 700s, and a famous French fighter, because this was a massive clash between the Islamic armies coming up through Europe. He references the Battle of Vienna, when Islam was stopped at the gates of Vienna, which again, in that world, was a big moment. He references Kosovo Polje, the Battle of Kosovo, a Serbian battle against the Turkish Empire. And then you come all the way up to the 1990s, and one of the songs he's listening to is referencing Radovan Karadzic, the Bosnian Serb leader in the 90s. Because again, in this warped worldview, this is a clash of civilizations in which that was part of standing up for white people. And then you go all the way up to really modern times. There's a reference to an Italian man, Luca Traini, who shot and wounded six North Africans a couple of years ago, who was recently sentenced, and Alexandre Bissonnet. He was, you might remember, he attacked a mosque in Quebec a couple of years ago. Well, he was only sentenced last month. He's very fresh, and this worldview, and there are people like this man in many countries dotted around the world, and they are all interlinked via the web, and they all know these buzz words, these emotional touch points, some of which I've just listed.
Yeah, he also cites Anders Breivik as a source of true inspiration, I think he describes himself of. That's coming in this manifesto, I suppose, called The Great Replacement. What does that tell us about him?
Again, it is this fear, and this is led by pseudo-intellectuals in the United States who talk about the possibility of the white people being replaced. And it's also something that's caught a little bit in the French extreme right imagination. And he's quite obsessed with France because France has the largest proportionally Muslim population.
And he cites the presidential election and the election of President Macron.
Who beat the National Front, Le Pen. Now, I'm not putting her and her party in this category, but it is on that road. And as I said, it's all part of this worldview that is frightened and feels itself threatened. And as I said, he will think of himself as a warrior. And he's referencing also, I think it's David Lane, American white supremacist who died in jail about 10 years ago, who had a manifesto. And as I said, there will be people in this country who will know some of this and believe in it. And they are all interlinked all over the world. And Breivik is quite key to this. I remember I went over for that terrible event with Breivik, and he knew what he was doing. He put up his manifesto. He became a figurehead. He has inspired people. This guy actually says he was in touch with Breivik. Now, if that's true, and if Breivik has had access via the internet in jail, then that's an issue for the authorities there to look at. This is part of a chain of events which are all linked.
And you talk about the internet there, because of course he live streamed this on Facebook. He's inciting others to go and seek out other sources, isn't he? And of course the publication of that manifesto is all about spreading this message globally.
This is slightly at a tangent, but it is part of a wider debate about a related subject, and that is about hate speech on social media. And how you can clamp down on it and what falls foul. And I did notice this morning, because I followed some of this stuff, on some of the, it's not dark web, but it is internet sites that you don't normally think of. the way people are messaging each other, they're cropping things so that it doesn't fall foul of the algorithms that can search out
these
things.
And I spotted that taking still images of the manifesto so that it isn't coming up.
Yeah, it's a photograph, not words. And on it goes. And so this is actually part of a much wider debate about the internet and the promulgation of hate. But the key idea here is of white supremacy, is of white people being under threat. Obviously this is at the very extremes, but it is part of a continuum of thought, which when you look at this craziness of being inspired by a battle from more than 1,000 years ago, and then taking that and going on to actually murder people, in this name that I don't think it's got much traction. It's certainly got very little traction in New Zealand. I mean, it's a tiny, tiny movement, the white supremacist movement, but this is proof that it's a global movement as well.
Tim Marshall, thank you.